I'm gonna call on Emily Davenport to introduce our special presentation.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm pleased to announce that we have representatives today from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Jacksonville District. They are here to do a presentation on the Wicklow-Coochee River Sugar Creek flood analysis for the city of Austin. We've been working on this project now for almost a year. Today, we've got Dave Apple, who is the chief of the watershed section planning in Austin Division, who will be giving the presentation. We also have Dave Tipple, who is here, the deputy chief of the planning in Austin Division, as well as Brian Corwell, who's hydraulic coupler, and John Campbell, who's your corporate communication office. But today, Dave Apple will do a presentation for you.
Here we go. City council members, first of all, I would like to thank you very much for inviting us here tonight and to discuss the project. I want to express on behalf of the Corps appreciation and help that we got from Mr. Hanson and his staff family, the Corps Impact Collins, and all the support and information that they provided to the Corps. This has been a great work relationship. This is one of the things that we really stress as a partnership between government agencies, being able to show how well we can work together and when we work together, what we can accomplish. So tonight, as I said, I'm going to be presenting to you the findings of the Wicklow-Coochee and Sugar Creek flood analysis that we have done for the city. And have any of you findings, give you some recommendations, and open it up for questions. As we go through the presentation, if you have some questions, please feel free to ask. That's one of the things we want to do tonight. Here's one for you. We want to make sure when we leave here, you have a thorough understanding of what the project is, what it's done, what it's accomplishing, and kind of the steps of where to go. So, Emily, zero.
Okay. Next slide.
Cheryl, you got it. Go ahead.
There is not, it's Adobe, so I'll have to click.
So, just tell her when you're ready to change slides.
So the first thing I want to talk about is the purpose of the analysis. And again, the whole purpose of this analysis was to do a flood study analysis of an area that the city had identified having problems with flooding. What we were trying to establish additionally is a federal interest. Why did we establish a federal interest? Because in the future, by showing that there is a federal interest in terms of flood damage reduction, that can bring in additional federal dollars in terms of additional studies and federal support to come up with solutions to try to address some flooding issues that are going on. Some of the ways we approach this is through our continuing authorities program, or as we refer to it as the CAP program. That can be a program where the Corps partners with a non-federal sponsor up to about $10 million. It's a 65-35 cost share. But that also brings construction dollars to the table, as well as self-study dollars and design dollars as well. The other one we're talking about, and we're talking more towards the end, is our watershed study authority. And we realize that the Valdosta is just a small part of a much larger watershed that's experienced a lot of problems. These problems are not just on the Georgia side, but also on the Florida side too. As I've always said in the past, the Swan River doesn't recognize state lines. What happens in the upper part of the basin also can affect the lower part of the basin and vice versa. With the watershed study, you can go in and start looking at those problems, those issues, but you can also start figuring out what are the goals, what are we trying to achieve, and how do we move forward with that. And what it does is gives you a roadmap of where you'd like to go. Next slide, please. Okay, I'd like to spend a little bit of time here on our modeling conditions. And this is important because in order to understand the study itself, we need to understand the model that went into this. In a planning study, modeling is like part of that study. If you don't have the existing conditions correct, you don't have the data, then you can't come up with the solutions that are going to help solve those problems because you've got to be able to simulate the conditions that are occurring out there in order to understand what's happening and to come up with a solution. One of the things we do want to point out is when we were going through our analysis. Do you have a question?
No, go ahead. I will have one.
Okay.
I'm sorry you read my mind.
able to, what the system has is to get the water out. The problem lies in those events that occur outside the city. And the other thing, when people think about modeling, they hear a 10-year, 50-year, or 100-year event. And people, some people equate that in their mind is, well, this is a storm event that's going to occur every 100 years, or this is a storm event that's going to occur every 50 years, or 10 years. I want to try to kind of frame up to you how the Corps does their modeling, and kind of explain a little bit, with the help of my associate Brian Cornwell, explain to you exactly what we did in the existing condition modeling, how we looked at this problem. And then that will lead into how we came up to the different alternatives that we looked at in the recommendation. When we talk about these storm events, it isn't just the duration of rainfall. What it is a statistical analysis that's looking at an exceedance. And it's not just rainfall, it's looking at rainfall, it's looking at flood levels and depth, and it's looking at flows. The other thing to remember here is that in the study, because of the size of the watershed, an event that may be occurring in the upper part, which somebody may classify as a 100-year event or 50-year event, may not be the same event that occurs down in the city itself. Because of the size, and because of the way the watershed is laid out. And again, the other thing that we need to look at is what available data is out there. Fortunately for us, the city had a lot of data. We also have two events that occurred in 2009-2013 that Brian was able to use in calibrating our model to be able to understand what was going on in the existing conditions. I'm going to take a second and just let Brian just quickly kind of run through you his what he had done on the modeling, how he set it up, and what he looked at, so that you kind of get in context of what we were doing in terms of the existing condition analysis, and then get a better understanding when we work to the future with condition analysis.
David, before you leave that slide, yes. I did have a question. I want to make sure I'm reading it correctly and understanding correctly, because that slide says that your analysis indicates that the flooding we experience is due to rising water in the Littlefusia and Little Rivers, which backs up into Sugar Creek.
That's right.
Which is creating the flooding. It's not a local event. It's not a local infrastructure issue. And of course, we are aware, we realize we were at sort of the bottom of the 1500 square mile drainage basin where the Little River and the Rinpoche merged, just north of our city. But I saw in your study on another page where y'all are also saying that this is actually one of the largest river drainage basins in the United States, that there's over almost 10,000 square miles.
That's correct. The Swan River is a huge watershed. And we look at the tributaries and the river itself, and different rivers that contribute to the swine. It's an expansive watershed. In terms of what you pointed out there, yes, that's correct. What we saw is the infrastructure in the city is more than adequate in handling these storm events that are coming through. That's not the problem. The problem you're having is when, on a sunny day condition, when you have those flows coming from upstream events that occur that are heading down towards the city, and of course, in the Withlacoochee area, we have Sugar Creek coming in that confluence. You have a little river in the Withlacoochee farther down confluence as well. Those all actually back up. And in terms of that, when the water starts backing up rising in the Withlacoochee, that's going back on Sugar Creek, and then that water is nowhere to go. Can't get out. So instead of flowing positive down, because you've got the positive drainage, you've got the gradient to move water down. When water can't get out, it's going to back up. And then that's when we start seeing those flooding events in those areas because the water isn't going to go.
We've also asked if you take a look, there was speculation that could have been other crosses, whether it be a railroad trestle or a bridge or a DOT interstate project that changed the bridge elevation, but you didn't find any evidence of any structural issue like that that has caused this flood.
That's correct. Okay. That's correct.
But while you're there,
yes,
a couple quick questions. You may not have found any structures, but surely the paving of large parking lots and stuff like that didn't help any,
correct?
With the drainage of water.
thing is, you have an infrastructure to move that one off. In this case, the infrastructure is there. That's from these rain events, that's not the problem. The problem that you have is from that water coming, coming from the stream.
Sure.
Right. And when a confluence is there, that's when you run into those problems. Because, as I said, when you have that confluence there at Sugar Creek and at the Withlacoochee, when the Withlacoochee is staging much higher, there's no place for that water to go.
Yeah, it is the great silver backing up.
Yes.
Well, sure. Silver backing up.
Right. It's not prevention. It's because the water cannot get out. And because of that, it is backing up.
All right. With the modeling and all the information you gathered,
mm-hmm.
when was, and you may have already said this and I apologize,
okay.
when was the last time something like this, the gathering of this much information on this watershed area, when was that done?
I'm not sure I think I understand your question.
The information that you've gathered to present us tonight,
mm-hmm.
has it ever been looked at this way before?
That I can't answer for you. All I can tell you is I know that there have been some studies that have been done. That's, the city supplied us with a lot of data that they have from some other studies that have done. I think some other agencies may have done some studies. When Mr. Cuomo was putting together his hydraulic analysis, developing the model, one of the things he did is he went research to see what all the data is out there from either USGS or National Weather Service. Because I can tell you this, lots of government agencies, you have different agencies that may be doing different modeling at different parts, not the exact same thing. And that's one thing I want to point out. How do you model? Agencies do modeling differently. How one agency may model something may be different from another agency. What we do see, though, is a lot of times is in terms of reviewing the data and the output from those models, if we're seeing it kind of matching up in terms of either flood levels or flows, that we're seeing that concurrency where, from what we're talking about, what we're seeing from some other model, that, we can tell the data and the information in the model, we're on track. And that's one of the things that Brian was able to see, is that when some of the modeling has been done, he could see where, we were matching up. And that gave, a greater degree of confidence in the model that we were doing, that when we calibrated, we felt very confident that we were able to really kind of get a very good handle on the existing conditions to see what was going on.
Councilman, again, you'll get this thick report, but there actually is, I thought I saw on page 11, there's a reference to a 1977 flood insurance study that was done. 1996 Master's Stormwater Management Plan for the city hired Bill Smith and Bill. 2002, we became a stormwater community. And so there's a number of references y'all have made in the year to studies that the city has done for years for our own infrastructure, our own stormwater management, but not necessarily these
reasons. So I think the context is what I just want to ask you is it's update all that information together, compile it together. I would say at this point, something like that, at least as far as I know, has not been done. But if there was a watershed study or a larger analysis, then that would be something you would be looking at, is taking all that data, those models that have been done, and using that to develop a comprehensive model.
That's going to be one of your conclusions at the end.
Yes.
Okay. And then the company we hired, was that used in any of this?
Yeah, y'all used a good bit of information we had in the previous. Used some of the modeling information, some of the information we got from FEMA.
We did. We said, in fact, Mr. Cuomo did talk to some of the models of the CDM, and from what the discussion they had, our model was matching up with the papers that we received in their model. So we felt very confident in the model that we put together.
I have a question. Apologize for this question to answer phase. And I'm not sure you can specifically get to what my question is through the presentation with it now, if you will. What I'm hearing from the constituents that live in my district. days. Of course, back in 2009, we were talking 500 to 750 years from our events. And obviously, 2009 to 2013 is not 750 years. And then now again, in 2014, we hit flood stages again this year, recently. And I think a lot of the folks that live in the city, their concern is, what is happening? What is going on that suddenly, over the last 4 years, our city and our community, not just the city of Austin, but the county as well, have experienced these flooding kind of situations? I think that's one of the things that our citizens want to know. And obviously, this is just a small picture of the total, as you mentioned.
Right.
And I think they're going to want to know that we're all going to work towards getting the answer to those kind of questions.
And that's one of the things that the board is trying to work towards. As I mentioned, the watershed study, that's for the size of the Stony River watershed, it really has been a comprehensive study. It's really important on both in Georgia and Florida. And looking back and seeing the problems that have been occurring here up in the upper part of the basin, as well as down in Florida, where we've seen the tropical storm Debbie went through. We saw Interstate 10 go underwater at Live Oak. We saw flooding down in Bay Area. We saw flooding in Live Oak in itself, too. And they realize that there is a need to look at the comprehensive, because this is a large watershed. There are a lot of tributaries that contribute to this. And in order to get those answers that you're looking for, Mr. Carroll, the watershed study would be able to provide that, because what we would do is we go in and look at these different areas. We look to see what's going on. In a watershed study, we develop a modeling that can give us a better idea, use these new tools that we have, try to get a handle on what's happening. We may be able to answer some of those questions. Some of it may be, we may be using infrastructure. Some of it may be how we manage the water. Those are different things that will be looked at. Some of it may be because of drought conditions, where ground becomes saturated, and all of a sudden, when you have a rainfall and you're saturating the ground, you have more runoff than the ground can absorb.
Those are things that we looked at. That, correct me if I'm wrong, and I think this will be one of your conclusions, but the fact that we partnered with you and paid 50% of this, and what your conclusions are, that there needs to be a bigger study, the entire watershed isn't actually going to make this eligible. You're asking for funds and the budget to do that bigger study, is that correct?
That's correct, Larry, because what we've done with this study is we've shown that there is federal interest. One of the federal interests is being able to show a reduction in flood damage. It's one of the things the board's mission on our business line is flood damage reduction. And you see it on the Mississippi River, the huge flood walls in Vicksburg and stuff, the flood plain that's going on. We put these levees, we put these systems in place because we're trying to reduce the level of funds and reduce that damage. That's when you see that reduce that damage. That's money the federal government does not have to put out. And that's a savings not only to the federal government, but also to the local government as well, too.
Because one thing we all have to do is better educate, because when there's a perception like that 100-year flood, that means it would happen once every 100 years. But what that really means, there's a 1% chance every year that that event will happen. So it's a matter of education as well.
And that's the thing, as we go through this, we want to educate a little bit on our modeling, how the board approaches these. Because once you understand the concept behind it, once you understand what we mean by these storm events, what we look at these storm events, that gives you a better understanding of the context. And then we'll be able to answer some of those questions as well. And one thing we've got pointed out on the slide is that once we turn over the report to the city, well, we will also be given a model that the city can use as a planning tool. And it's not just a conceptual model. It is a model that contains data that can be used to look simulate conditions out there and look at other alternatives for expanding on that model to look at larger areas. So that was one of the things that we wanted to be able to get to the city out of this study, so that they have some tools that they can use in planning. Go to the next slide, please. Well, before we go, is there any other questions?
The one more question I have, what is the layman's definition of a watershed?
It's the area in which all the water drains to its point.
Oh, there's a connectivity, large, connectivity.
to explain that is if you look at a leaf, the shape of a leaf of this, in the center, the water on the leaf as it comes to the center, it brings towards the center and down to the lowest point. And as Brian pointed out, that's what a water, you know, basic definition of a watershed is. In this case, with the swamp, your headwaters are up at the swamp, and where it's all going to be down to is the big bin area of the Gulf of Mexico.
So our leaf is overflowing.
Excuse me?
Our leaf is overflowing.
In some areas, yes. Depending on, you know, the rain, you know, the events that's going on there, what's happening in the basins, that can affect a lot of the drainage in these areas.
Okay. Did you want him to enter into?
Yeah, basically what we did is we built a hydraulic model of not only Sugar Creek, Two Mile Ranch, but more importantly, or equally important, as is Coosa River and also the Little River. We set our boundaries up where we had data, USGS gauges, for, you know, up the Little River. Above you guys, I believe it was Higgins, Georgia, below here, US 84, here equipment. And so this set our boundaries in the model. We have the 2013 event. We have good data on all those gauges for the 2013 event you guys had. So we use that as a calibration run to kind of say, okay, how is it reproducing that one way of moving down? Very instrumental was the model that Camp Freshman McKee, you guys contracted with them to simulate the hydrology within the city of Valdosta, the rainfall runoff response. That would be a lot of work for us to develop. It was very helpful that that one to use this. So basically what we do is we dump a rainfall event. We have the 2013 rainfall time series record. We dump that out of the city. That produces the flows that go out. And then we have the stages and flows in the Coosa River that simulate how it's going to work. That's basically the main part of this. So we set it up to calibrate to the 2013 event. And then through a statistical analysis of all those different places, we come out and say, okay, what were the peaks? That way we can take, once we have this existing kitchen model, we're happy with it, then we can implement these structural changes and we can see what the resulting water levels will be, and we can even map those. Very similar to how the flood maps that we developed in the state of Arizona. That's the main thing with it is, I mean, is there any specific questions anyone has about any of this? I know we talk about statistics and things like that, and can get kind of distracted, sir.
We did some classes once with our kids, and they had a model that you put on the table.
Yeah.
That's the opposite.
That's what we call physical models.
Okay.
We still, yeah, the Corps of Engineers actually still builds physical models. Vicksburg, Mississippi, we have our Engineering Research Development Center. We build sizes warehouses of physical models, but generally it's much easier, much cheaper, and quicker to build numerical models. And so we have a software package. We use GIS to pull in the topography. We have very high resolution data that is already existing. It didn't cost anything to get this data. We can cut cross sections on that data. We bring it into the software package. These software packages are developed and serviced by a Corps of Engineers. We have what we call Hydrologic Engineering Center. They develop many software packages for us. They're state of the art, they're leaders in this field. So we can pull the terrain into this model. We can put flows into the top. We can say, okay, this needs cubic feet per second coming down. At the bottom, here's what the stage is. Simulates the laws of physics, how the water moves, and you can simulate how the water is going to move without having to build a physical tabletop model. That's how we used to do it. It's all my computer.
Yeah. So long term, if you're doing a watershed wide analysis, you're going to kind of do the same thing with rain gauge information.
Scale. We would zoom out, and it would require so much more data. We would, like, for this study, like I said, we use the big thing for a model is how you set your boundaries. You know, where does the model end? And so we generally try to do that at a gauge. That gauge we know that that's what the water level wants. So I can just plug that in. With the watershed study, we would need to pull in things like land use. We would need to look at groundwater. Many, many more creeks and streams. A lot of data, a lot of meteorological. What's the vegetation like? A lot of things that affect how water flows, the resistance to the flow.
much more intensive model. Like I said, a lot of the data, actually all of the data, already existed either within USGS stages or data that anyone ordered us from other work we had already contracted out past. We were able to do all this with existing data we need for life.
Just out of curiosity, I know this is specific to the city of Alaska, but as you look at watershed-wide studies, now that we've had a number of decades with wetlands, mitigations, and things of that nature, we, understandably, have lost a lot of natural wetlands over the course of decades. Have you, in any other jurisdiction, seen any studies as to what kind of impact loss of natural wetlands has in the whole process?
Yes, it's called the Everglades Restoration Act that we're doing down in South Florida. In fact, that's what we're looking at on a massive scale. We're looking at the research in Everglades, and that encompasses most of South Florida, South Florida, if you show me. It's a much larger effort, and it involves not only numerous efforts in modeling, but very sophisticated models. We're also going on and collecting ground data as well. And we're looking at the effects that agriculture, urban growth has had on the wetlands and the effect that it has on the actual urban itself.
Let's go on with the rest of the presentation then, Dave.
Okay. So this next slide, basically, once we developed the existing condition model, we felt very comfortable, we had an idea what's going on. We then started looking at alternatives. In a typical core study, you want to develop measures and combine them together into what we call alternatives to come up with solutions to try to address that. And you identify what the problems are, you identify what are the opportunities we have out there, what's the goal we're trying to achieve, and how do we get there. In this case, we looked at we looked at seven alternatives. And as we went through, again, because of the limited time and funds on this, we narrowed it down. In terms of alternatives, we did look at full acquisition, which would be in a typical portfolio, so this would be acquiring real estate. But we looked at grazing structures out there. We looked at combination grazing structures and acquiring real estate. We looked at channelization of the local community, and we looked at also changing conflicts in the Little River and the local community. And then finally, the last alternative we looked at is flood control levels. Now, the first six we eliminated because a lot of those costs or environmental impacts. Basically, alternatives two, one, two, and three costs are required to be a raising of the structure. We looked at alternatives five and six, significant costs are again, and a lot of environmental impacts. So now we're down to alternative seven, which was looking at living in a structure in terms of trying to address the flooding issues going on. So next slide, please. So basically, it's kind of gives you an overall view of the alternative seven. And what we're looking at is a levee with flat-gated culverts. The levee is about 4,000 feet long and about 40 feet high. And it contains culverts with flat gates so that when the Withlacoochee rises, those flat gates will close to prevent tap water going into Sugar Creek. Before we move on, are there any questions down this slide? Next slide, please. So alternative seven, this kind of gives you kind of a concept of what we were talking about in terms of the levee culvert concept. So if you look at the top, you can see the flow of water in Withlacoochee. With Withlacoochee stage, you're lower. The flat gates are open. Water flows out of Sugar Creek into Withlacoochee, so you have that positive flow. In a condition where you have that dry, we call sunny day event, where because events in the upper part of the basin have increased flows, in Withlacoochee causing a rise in elevation of flow levels in Withlacoochee, the slack gates close and prevent that water from going into Sugar Creek. So you don't have that all that water going in. Now, again, that does prevent water from going up to Sugar Creek, but you don't have the added on of the water.
to go to Sugar Creek, near example.
It's going to pond, but here's the thing, without that levee over in place, it wasn't going anywhere anyway, because the water, if you would have actually had more flow coming in, so at least you don't have water coming in. Now, granted, it doesn't have anywhere to go, but it didn't have anywhere to go.
And we'll do it.
Higher water levels in the future, so.
So we'll just have some rides over here.
Yeah, but, and that's part of the problem, because with the rising up, and that's that water Sugar Creek going out, and then also you have the fishing water coming in.
Generally, these events, you're seeing the rainfall falls, water rushes out, and then you got a day or two later, and water with the fishing start to come up.
Well, but this gets to the councilman's question. Are we really, with a levy, just pushing the problem somewhere else? Which this is my district, so.
I don't think.
I'm not unhappy pushing the problem somewhere else. But this is what I worry about, is pushing the problem, because the water's got to go somewhere.
Well, the water, I mean.
And really, and truthfully, in a flood event, you've indicated the water's coming from the north down. So there's not a whole lot coming down Sugar Creek. There could be some instances where that's going to cause flooding because it won't be let out by the levee. But the width of the Coochie and Little River water has got to go somewhere. So are we pushing the flooding just somewhere else?
That's I would answer that by saying, if you look at the volume of water that's not being allowed to go back up Sugar Creek, quantity of water is minuscule compared to the quantity of water that's in the Little Coochie and Little Rivers. So it's not like you're going to impact anything downstream. I mean, you've got this much water, and you're just preventing this much of it from getting back up.
Plus, flooding is really not the water coming down Sugar Creek, it's the water back.
Sure. Exactly. You're just not allowing. It's not like you're putting more out there. You're just allowing less of it to come.
So we have a real rainstorm. Sugar Creek rises. Overflows and everything, but that water gets out there before the water comes down from the litigation. And so you've lowered the level of Sugar pretty substantially before you start receiving that flood of water from the north.
If we have a several day event where it's still falling in the city, flowing throughout the city to Sugar Creek, the levee's in place and the water's coming from the north too. The Sugar Creek water has nowhere to go but its banks.
I would answer it like this.
Because it's blocked again.
In order for those flat gates to close, you have to have a higher water level downstream. If that's the case, your water's not going anywhere. Right. It's coming.
It would be like there is now.
Yeah. The water's not going to flow uphill, so it's either.
Wouldn't make any worse if we're going to make any better.
Exactly.
Right. Is just that answer your question?
Well, it does. We've just had instances where we've had 3, 4, 5 inches of rain and Sugar Creek overflows. That has nothing to do with the Coochie. It's the amount coming down as fast as it's coming down. Nothing's going to handle it. So, but I worry about it if that were the case and the levee's closed. Flood before the water from them. Well, I guess the levees wouldn't close if the water hasn't got up.
It
wouldn't
be it works. It's not right there, but it is actually a privilege. In fact, the diagram we show here on turn 7, kind of using a cross section of what a levee would look like. And what we have in there is notice in the middle of that gray area, that's like a filter type of blanket where you prevent pipe in some where you don't have water. Along the culvert and washing it out. Also, we put on what we call freeboard. That's additional storage above the flood elevation so that you don't have that over top. So you can see there on the left that elevation 143, I believe, mine is the 100 year.
It's actually a little greater than that. That's 125% of the 100 year. You generally build overbuilt things a little bit. You never know. And wind. Not strong too well, so that's
into the Withlacoochee, or so it will.
Yeah, we have to, if you want to back up a couple, we have to see that.
Yeah, I saw that. I just, it was hard to see that.
These locations aren't set in stone. We move forward, we can adjust the preference so that we can look at things.
All right, and to do this, would we have to, or someone, have to purchase land to do this? Or is this government land to begin with?
No, they have to acquire land through some means.
And that would fit into the price?
Okay, so again, this kind of gives you an idea of what we